Hello everyone. So maybe you've seen my last video about this topic, but every few months, the debate about bias in machine learning models is resurfacing. And this time, a tweet by Kareem Carr is sort of in the middle of it. And he says, four things to know about race and gender bias in algorithms. First, the bias starts in the data. Second, the algorithms don't create the bias, but they do transmit it. Third, there are a huge number of other biases. Race and gender bias are just the most obvious. And fourth, it's fixable. And what followed was what I thought was a pretty sensible tweet or thread about bias in machine learning and in statistics in general and what to do about it, namely the plea for understanding your data better and other suggestions. Now, there's a follow-up tweet to this that is here saying, oh, this thread is doing numbers. There are a few comments disagreeing with this thread. One thing to keep in mind as you read them, as far as I can tell, they are misinterpreting what I said because they are using a different definition of bias. And I think this really hits the nail on the head. Specifically, he got a lot of heat for saying the first thing here, the bias starts in the data. Now, every time you talk about these things, there are a number of people coming out saying, it's not the data, the problem is not the data, or the problem is not only the data. And I have to admit, I also had a little bit of a wrong impression of what that actually means. And I think the solution is in recognizing that people are using different definition of bias, and that leads to a situation where people talking past each other. So in my last video, I've pointed out there are many different things that can go wrong with a machine learning pipeline and where bias can be introduced. And I raised a plea to not confuse them, because what people will do is they will point to one problem and then suggest a solution that is relevant for a different problem. Now, as far as I understand it, when Kareem talks about the bias starts in the data and is transmitted by models, what he means is statistical bias, which means that either the dataset is sampled in a wrong way and doesn't represent the world as it is, which I also discussed, or that the model itself, the choices we make during training and the loss function and the choice of architecture, lead to a situation where the model output does not represent the world. This refers to statistical bias, and statistical bias is in part necessary for us to build models that do generalize well, but it can be a problem, and I think everyone acknowledges that. But when people say the problem is not in the data, I think they usually mix up two different things. The first thing they mix is what I'm showing right here. There are problems with building the models itself that can amplify a bias in the data, or if they are really bad models, even create bias that was not present in the dataset. On the other hand, I also pointed out that a lot of people actually have a problem not with the data itself, but with reality. So the bias they're talking about is bias that already exists in the world. And here, the machine learning model is sort of viewed as a tool of social engineering. And very often, evidence for wrong loss functions are brought up to show that there is bias that is not in the data, but then the fixes that are suggested for it are targeted towards bias that is in reality. So my plea last time was, let's not confuse the different things that go wrong and how we fix them. It's perfectly viable to talk about changing reality, to talk about using a machine learning model to influence reality. We all know there are feedback loops and other influences that these AI systems have. And I think we should then honestly come out and say, when we talk about debiasing, what we actually mean is we want to bias the machine learning model such that it outputs a world that we want to have and not the world that we actually have as a tool for social engineering. So today we're going to have a look at a thing that I wanted to have a look for a while, and those are these AI explorables. They're made by Google and they're kind of cool interactive things that give you a visual impression of what can go wrong with machine learning models. Right now they have these in the fields of privacy and also fairness and bias. So I thought today we'd look at the ones in the fairness and bias section, with special regard to people saying the problem is not in the data. Now, if you actually look at who's making these arguments and who's making these explainables, there is a pretty big overlap between who is making the explainables and who is saying the problem is not in the data. So if there is good evidence for the fact that the problem is not in the data, I expect that these explainables will give us a bit of a hint about that. So my hypothesis as I go through this is going to be, yes, the problem is in the data, either because the data is sampled incorrectly, in which case we can simply focus on sampling a better data set, or in the other case, because reality is not as we want it, and that is reflected in the data, in which case we're not debiasing, we are actively biasing. But I guess you can see for yourself. So the first explorable deals with measuring fairness. And essentially, it's saying that imagine there is a disease. And if you had a perfect test for the disease, you would have no problem. So all the people in red here are sick, whereas all the people in gray are well. And the perfect test would be able to recognize all the sick people and not recognize all the well people. 100% accuracy, not a problem. This is not the case in reality, though. Usually, we have tests that aren't exactly perfect, so you'll always end up with people who are sick, but not recognized, the ones down here, and people who are not sick, but the test says they are sick. I'm sorry, it's really hard. I have to draw off screen and hit the region that I'm targeting. It's an experiment. Now, these tests usually don't just say you're sick or you're not sick. They usually give you a probability of being sick. Now, the question is, where do you cut off? Do you say a person is sick when the test is 99% sure? Do you say a person is sick when the test is 50% sure? And here is where you have to make a choice. One choice is to never miss the disease, which means that as soon as my test says this person might be sick, I already put them into the sick category. I won't ever miss anyone, or I'll just miss really few people down here, but you can see I have a large swath of people that aren't sick, but the test says they're sick, just because I'm so conservative. On the other hand, I could say, I just want to be really sure, so I only classify anyone as sick if the test is really sure. You can see now that very few people that aren't sick end up in the positive group. However, you have a lot of people who are sick who are not detected because you simply don't trust the test unless it's really, really sure. The aggressiveness gives you a handle on the threshold here. So full aggressiveness means that as soon as the test says there might be something wrong, you classify a person as sick. On the other hand of the spectrum, you just want to be really, really sure. And you can see while you miss half the sick people, you don't make any errors on healthy people. So how does this play into fairness? The fairness aspect comes in when we consider different subgroups. They say things get even more complicated when we check if the model treats different groups fairly. Whatever we decide in terms of trade-offs between these metrics, we probably like them to be roughly even across different groups of people. If we're trying to evenly allocate resources, having the model miss more cases in children than adults would be bad. So on the right, you can see that now we split the population into children and adults. And you can see something's going on here. Namely, in this fictitious world, the base rates are different. This is known as the base rate problem, and you can see that the disease seems to be more prevalent in children just from the fact that they are children. And this results in kind of a weird situation with what we had before. See, wherever you set the threshold, you're going to have a different proportion of adults and children that you misdiagnose in one way or another. So on the bottom here, you see the recall, which is right now equal for children and adults, but due to the differing base rates, the children have a much higher precision than the adults. So if, for example, there was some kind of worldwide pandemic and you're an adult, you might rightfully claim that this is unfair because just by how the threshold is set, you go to quarantine much more easily than a child, even if you are healthy. So you might plead for raising up the threshold, but again, that would not be fair to the children. And even if you allow for having different thresholds for the different groups, due to the differing base rates, you'll never be able to bring both the precision and the recall to be equal for the different groups. Now, I've looked at all of the different numbers, and you can see right here, I've plotted precision versus recall. For adults, it looks about like this, and for children, it looks about like this. So you can see as these curves are never intersecting, you'll never manage to find any threshold for either group that where both precision and recall match. In their conclusion to this article is somehow you cannot satisfy every single notion of fairness at the same time, which of course I agree with, but you can clearly see that the reason this whole phenomenon happens is because you have the differing base rates which draw these two curves away from one another. But let's examine our hypothesis again. Is the problem here in the data? And I would argue, yes, absolutely. The problem is in reality. And reality makes it such that children are more often sick. So reality is at the cause for this problem. And this reality gets into the data. So very directly, at least in this particular problem, the problem is in the data. The next explainable is called hidden bias. And the situation is, let's pretend we're college admission officers trying to predict the GPA students will have in college. This is not real data, this is simulated data. So here we take a simple machine learning model and let it predict the college GPAs. So on the x-axis, you see what we're trying to predict. And on the y-axis is our model trying to predict it. So the further away we are from the middle line, the worse we're doing. And you can see here if our only input variable, and that's what it says at the top, is the high school GPA, we're doing pretty badly. We can increase that performance by providing the model with more data. You can see that the points shifted towards the line, meaning we make less mistakes. Now they introduce the problem. They say if a sexist college culture has historically led to lower grades for female students, it is here in purple, the model will pick up on that correlation and predict lower grades for women. Training on historical data bakes in historical biases. And they also say, here the sexist culture has improved, but the model learned from the past correlation still predicts higher grades for men. So essentially saying, in the past, women were subject to sexism and therefore had lower grades. However, this is no longer the case, and now the model trained on the old data still makes that mistake. Notice that this falls pretty clearly into the skewed sampling and out-of-date data category. So right off the bat, the problem is in the data. So the first thing they point out here is that if we simply don't give the model access to the variable gender, the problem might still persist because the model will simply find correlations between gender and then use that to predict. And honestly, how could the model do any different in the world that it sees and the data that it has? The purple dots are actually performing poorer. So the most accurate thing to do is to score them lower. Again, the problem here is clearly in the data, and we need to get more accurate data that better reflects the real world as it is. We all agree that if we don't have the correct data, our model is going to learn all the mistakes that are in the data set. So conclusion one from this explainable is that just because you take out a protected attribute from the model, it doesn't mean that you can fix bias, because the model can simply find other variables that are correlated, which is absolutely true. The next thing they're saying is that, as intuitive as it might seem, to exclude a protected attribute from the algorithm, it might even be beneficial to explicitly include a protected attribute. So here they have a different machine learning model. This time they still want to predict the college GPA. However, their only input variable is the score that one alumni interviewer gives to a student. Now, it just so happens that this student has a personal bias against people from low-income households, here in red. So here they say, in our toy model, students' grades don't depend on their income once they're in college. In other words, we have biased inputs and unbiased outcomes. The opposite of the previous example, where the inputs weren't biased, but the toxic culture biased the outcomes. So we've completely switched frames right now. We're basically relying on this one person to interview all the people. And it is the case that, you know, when this person says yes, the GPA is probably going to be good and vice versa. So we still have this linear relationship. However, that person has a personal bias. So necessarily, this is going to influence our decisions in a bad way. And here they argue that if we explicitly include the income, the model can compensate for this. So the model can recognize that if there is a person from a low-income household, it probably shouldn't trust that assessment of the interviewer as much. So conclusion one was that if you have biased target variables, like you have this out-of-date data, then even excluding the protected attribute might not be enough to fix the bias. Conclusion two from this experiment, however, says that if you have accurate targets, like here we have actual data from how well people performed, then giving the model access to all the data may help. So it's not as easy as simply telling the model, don't look at this one particular variable. But again, let's look at it from the perspective of, is the bias in the data? And clearly here in the second example, the problem was only there when we only relied on that biased interviewer. So again, the bias was in the data, and as soon as we acquired better data, more variables, we fixed the problem. Either because the data was sampled incorrectly, or because reality itself simply isn't as we want it. The third explainable is called measuring diversity. This is the most strongly worded one of the three, and I think it makes it the most explicit, which is something that I'm thankful for. So they say search, ranking, and recommendation systems can help find useful documents in large datasets. However, these datasets reflect the biases of the society in which they were created, and the systems risk re-entrenching those biases. For example, if someone is not a white man, searches for CEO pictures and sees a page of white men, they may feel that only white men can be CEOs. So the argument is one that I also made in my video, and it is that if we implement these systems, they will have an effect on society, and that effect might be not what we want. But it is important to remember that this is an entirely different problem from skewed data sets or different loss functions. And when you click on the link that they cite, you get to this article, The Top Jobs Where Women Are Outnumbered by Men Named John. And it is an astounding display of the disparities that are present in some jobs. Now, while it is a valid question to ask why that is and what might be at the cause of these problems, it's pretty clear that this is the state of the world, and any machine learning model outputting this as a search result reflects the world accurately. And the problems with these models aren't really that they don't reflect the world as is, but what the people are criticizing is that the output is not what they would like it to be. And they have their reasons. There are valid feedback loops. And the reason they give here is that they may feel that only white men can be CEOs. My problems with these types of arguments is that search engines quickly cease to be search engines and are much more like wish engines. Like, why use a search engine when I already know what I want to come out? But I do appreciate the honesty, so now we are truly in the field of social engineering, we're in the field of making the outputs of these models as we want. So here they have a toy data set. You can see there are squares, and these squares, they come in three different colors, they come in two different sizes, and some of them have a circle and some of them don't. So here the first task is to select green boxes such that the representation of green boxes is 30%. Now, given that there are three green boxes, you can just select the three green boxes and make sure that you select 10 boxes in total, and you'll meet that. Notice that that has nothing to do with a search engine now. This is simply we have a target of green boxes and we're trying to meet that target. We can, of course, do the same thing with the number of dots and the sizes. And it gets interesting once we have different intersecting targets. So we want 30% of our subset to be green, 35% to have a dot, and 60% to be small. And while you can almost solve this problem, the point they're making right here is that now it suddenly becomes important what difference metric you choose. If you choose the mean difference metric between your targets and the actual group you're choosing, the result will be different from when you choose, for example, the absolute difference. And you can see this right here. So here they give you the best choices according to targets that you set on the left, and they show you where they rank in terms of the different metrics. So the sequence that is best in terms of mean difference is only second best in terms of max difference. And as you change around these sliders, you can see that this changes, and you can see how the rankings here become pretty wild. So they go into this question of which measure is best. In a vacuum, they say all of these ranking methods are defensible. Picking one requires knowledge of the dataset and broader societal context. For example, the doctors on the left have more variance along the shirt color attribute, but they're less diverse by gender than the doctors on the right. With the shirt color and gender targets we've picked, the two subsets have the same mean and max differences. However, in most applications, it's more important to have a representative sample of socially relevant characteristics like gender rather than something less salient like color. So the point is that if they pick the subset on the left, it might be quite diverse with respect to white or blue colored shirts, but it might not be as diverse with respect to gender. However, on the right side, you can see that everyone's wearing a white shirt. However, genders are more equally represented. So I don't really get the jump here. We went from the metric you choose makes a difference in how the subgroups are represented to which attribute we choose makes the different attributes differently represented. And all of that has not really a lot to do with search engines per se, because I still don't get why I wouldn't want my search engine to just represent the world as it is. But pretty clearly, you can see that if you are not satisfied with the representation of a particular shirt color, of a particular gender, or other protected attributes, what you're essentially saying is that reality isn't as you want it, that reality comes into the dataset, and then the dataset is not as you want it. So the problem is in the data. And they go one step further and say that it's actually not as easy as simply including something like gender. So here you have stock photos for construction workers that seem to be very balanced on gender. But if you look at the feminine presenting individuals and other gender representations, they're depicted as historic, nostalgia, toys, clip art, or passive. And I mean, these are certainly valid problems, but this is now truly a wish machine and not a search machine anymore. I think maybe a more accurate solution to this problem would just be to tell people that just because a search engine outputs a bunch of results, that is not a prescriptive description of the world. It is rather a descriptive representation of the training data, which might or might not reflect the world as it is. I think people are in general a bit more competent than simply seeing a bunch of images on a website and thinking, oh, I'm going to now make my life decisions in accordance with what I saw here when I typed a construction worker into Google. So that was it on the PAIR AI Explorables on the topics of fairness. And every single time we saw that the problem is clearly in the data itself or in the reality that then influences the data. Again, which is fine, but I think when we talk about these things, we should be clear about what kind of bias we mean and then suggest solutions that are specifically for that kind of bias. All right, that was it for me. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.